Thank you, Trisha. Okay, I don't have many slides, so I'll just quickly go through and then we can go for questions. Stop me anywhere if you have any questions. Sorry? Okay, so how many, show of hands, how many of us know Cypress already? Are you using it in your work? How about you? Okay, anyone using JavaScript based Selenium, Nightwatch.js kind of? Okay, okay, that's good. So, so let's see what we are gonna see here. I would like to talk about the challenges in modern web automation. So we started with open source wise, we started with Selenium RC. So, but now we have a lot going on in the web automation. Right? Even in the web, there are a lot of frameworks, especially in the JavaScript side. And since most of us will be familiar when open source, it's most of us will be familiar with WebDriver. So I would like to compare WebDriver with Cypress. How does it compare? And then some key features in Cypress that really stands out when compared with other tools. Yeah, and other basic concepts with Cypress, and if possible, a demo. Hope it doesn't break. Okay, so in looking back, the web will be mostly server-based rendering, right? A lot happened on the server, and very little happened in the client. And the server sends a HTML page, and the browser just displays it. That was long back, but now we have come to an advanced state wherein we can do everything from the client side itself. Server is just rendering the initial page, and the client, by using the JavaScript, it makes a XHR request and a lot of AJAX requests happening. But Selenium RC or WebDriver was built long back. Like in fact, 10 years, 12 years back, right? So it wasn't really catching up with the latest happening in the web automation. I'll explain why in the next slide. And there are a lot of improvements on the architecture, a lot of happening there, but WebDriver wasn't really catching up. Okay, so key difference is, stop me whenever you have any questions, I'll try to address as much as possible. So the key difference is WebDriver is synchronous. Synchronous in the sense, there are four major layers in WebDriver. One, the client bindings, which we write automation code, and then the server, which gets the request from the bindings, and then we have the browser driver, and then the actual browser. So there are four major layers to it. And as you see, due to the REST API call between the client bindings and the server, every call is a synchronous call, right? Hope I'm making sense here. Whereas, let us look back at the web. So initially, a client requests for a web page, and server gives an initial page, and then a lot happening in the client side, right? So we all give a URL, but then the browser requests multiple, the JavaScript requests multiple pages in between, and then without any page refresh, it displays in the web browser, right? But from WebDriver point of view, we just give the URL, and we don't have a real understanding of what's happening behind the scenes, right? Whereas in Cypress, the Cypress process runs in the same loop as the web application. So we have the hold on the, we have events happening in the website, so we can react to the events that are happening in the website, and basically we can validate the events. And the other key difference is the retry ability. In WebDriver, we have to, as Shyam mentioned, we have to look for web elements, and then we have to iterate through it, look for it, wait for it. There are different weights available, and it's up to the implementer to really use it, right? And iterate it as and when the page loads. Whereas in Cypress, the retryability is inbuilt. So for to give an example, when we make a request in Cypress will ask for a page, and it has a hold on the website, and it waits until the event is happening, and then it fires and then it validates again. The other difference is multiple selectors versus CSS. In WebDriver, we have multiple selectors, ID, we have CSS, we have XPath, but unfortunately, Cypress only works on JS because that's how it's built. And the other difference is HTTP stateless and stateful clients. I discussed just now. In WebDriver, it is stateless, meaning we all have URL and we send it. We don't know what's happening on the browser side. It's just stateless. Whereas in Cypress, it's stateful because Cypress runs in the same loop as the app, and it knows what's happening in the browser side, and it can react based on the events that get fired in the browser. Right? This is a key difference we have with Cypress. And the other difference is end-to-end. WebDriver, we can do only end-to-end, meaning we cannot really stub responses. We can only make a request, and then it hits the real server, and then gets the response back, and then we can validate the DOM. Whereas in Cypress, we have the opportunity to do integration level test as well. Cypress has access to the JavaScript code from the app, node code, as well as it can run unit tests. It can import a JavaScript file from the app code, and it can run test against it. So basically, we can write a hybrid level test in Cypress, whereas in WebDriver, we can write only end-to-end test. This difference stands out when we have a network request which takes time, whereas in WebDriver we can make a request and have to wait for it. But in Cypress we can mock the response and then validate the client side. And another point I missed out, so WebDriver, the browser driver is implemented across major browsers, whereas Cypress works only in Chromium. Chromium-based, Electron, we have Canary, we have Chrome. So these three browsers are supported. Firefox support is in progress, but it's still not implemented.
Does it work headless?
Sorry?
Does it work headless?
Headless, it works in Electron, but still not there in Chrome. Okay, feature-wise, we have something called time travel. So time travel is nothing, but we have the opportunity to look at the DOM state for each and every request before and after the request is made. I'll show you in the test runner, so we can have a really look at the DOM before and after the request is made to the made from the browser. And debuggability, we can stop when the test is in progress and look at what's happening in the DOM. Right, that really helps us. Whereas in WebDriver, we don't have access to the Chrome DevTools. We don't have access to the other underlying network layer resources. Whereas in Cypress, we have the ability to do it. And another thing is real-time reloads. We can retry and real-time load the request from Cypress. Automatic waiting. In WebDriver, we have to make explicitly the wait and then iterate on it, or put in a loop and wait on it. Whereas in Cypress, it's inbuilt. We don't have to really write a code to iterate through a wait. So every time when a request is made, we have a timeout specified in the configuration, and until the timeout is made, Cypress automatically retries the command. Spy stubs and clocks, It's related to the network request. We can stub responses and then look at the how the client displays it. Network traffic control, we can, even in the end-to-end test, we have the opportunity to look at the response and validate it. Whereas in WebDriver, we don't have access to the network responses. This is one really good difference. Consistent results. This is related to the flakiness which we discussed. I hope there were like multiple questions on the timeout. The reason is I just said we had four layers in WebDriver, right? Irrespective of the implementation, we have at least four layers. So the moment the request is sent from the client binding, we don't really know what is the state of the application in the browser, right? We have a notification when the page load is complete, but between the page is initially loaded and the page load is complete, we don't really know what it is happening in the DOM, and we really shoot in the dark assuming it's there, and if it's hit, it passes, otherwise it's a flaky test. Whereas in Cypress, as I said earlier, we have access to the DOM at each and every request made, and we have a control on the events fired in the app, and then we can validate on the responses.
Yep.
And Shyam also mentioned about the screenshot and the videos for Appium, but Cypress gives you inbuilt. We don't need to write any code for it. It's just there. Okay, so Cypress is built as an NPM module. So basically, it's a binary and a wrapper on a node module. We can also install using Yarn. In Windows, if you install NPM, then it's pretty simple. It's the same as NPM install Cypress.
Yep.
I'd like to show you the installation from command line. I have the iTerminal. Is it visible? Okay. So I'm making a directory. So I have npm installed already. Normally the Cypress code is developed along with the app code. So since I don't have access to my app code here, it's confidential, so I'm just trying to create an empty module. So this creates basically a package.json, as you can see. So if we write from the application source code, then we'll be having a lot of libraries here and the source code here. So the next command would be to install Cypress. So this installs Cypress as a node module within the local the repository in which it's installed. SaveDev will add as a dependency in the package.json. Okay, there are some warnings, but yeah, it has installed already. So as you can see, we have node modules now. Okay, wait a second. So now we have node modules, and we have the package log.json and package.json. I'm opening this in Visual Studio Code. So Cypress is added as a dev dependency here.
That's a side question. What is the log difference between log and?
Okay, so package.json is a dependency manager to maintain the dependencies. Okay, so before an app is built, whatever versions that gets installed as a dependency for the project, a lock is made for that so that it doesn't change. Yeah, so if you want to change the version of any particular library, then you have to delete the lock and then run bundle it. Yeah, then install again. Yeah. So we have Cypress added as a dependency here under the node module. So we run Cypress now. So Cypress is under the node module bin, and then I'm just opening the Cypress test runner. So this opens up an Electron app. So Cypress has a pretty good documentation already. So as you can see, a lot of examples, specifications that are built by the Cypress team. So we have, if we look at the project directory, so Cypress has created a directory called Cypress. So it has created a directory called Cypress, and it has created a file called cypress.json. So all configurations that we make for Cypress goes under cypress.json. For example, if we want to give a URL that we want to test against, then we can put it as a base URL there. We can configure the timeouts. Yeah, extra. So now I have the test runner. We can just target the run against the browser. Currently it's Chrome 73, as you can see at the right top. Okay, let me run anything. So it opens up Cypress own browser, Chrome browser, and it runs the test against the website. So this is a sample app built by the Cypress team, example.cypress.io, and it runs different tests against it. So I'll go through each and everything one by one. Okay, so when we installed Cypress and opened it, what it created was a Cypress directory, right? So under this Cypress directory, we have fixtures, and we have integration, and we have plugins, and then we have support. So fixtures is something which any data that we want to use in the test or specifications, we can put it in here. And all the tests goes under the integration. We can subfolder it, and we can run only the specific subfolder for filtering. And plugins, any capability that we want to add to Cypress, that goes in here. For example, we can Cypress by default supports only CSS, whereas if we install another plugin, then we can Cypress supports XPath also. So those kind of plugins go in here. And support any command extension. For example, Cypress supports default commands, and these commands could be overridden or can be extended, or new commands can be added also. So that could be added in the commands.js. Okay, as I talked about, there are different configurations, base URL and environment. Environment, we can target against different environment. Timeout, there are different timeouts here. Default command timeout is what the timeout that specifies the amount of milliseconds that Cypress wants to wait for each and every command. And page load timeout is what when Cypress requests for a page and it waits this much time for timeout. As I said, we can also make custom request, and we can specify the timeout in the request timeout. We can also specify the timeout for the response also. And for folders, we can customize the videos folder, fixtures folder, plugins file. We can keep it in a different folder as we want, and then configure it in the configuration. Cypress.json. Okay, so from concepts wise, Cypress borrowed different concepts from different frameworks. So the test structure concept was borrowed from Mocha. So anybody worked with Mocha? Okay, then it will be familiar to you. So we have something called specifications, which contains a group of tests we can target against. So inside a specification, we have a describe block, and then inside the describe block we have context, and inside the context we have multiple test cases, right? So it specifies the test cases block. So we can either use specify or it. So it depends on the user's preference. So the format follows the JavaScript specification. So everything is written within the parentheses. So we should really get used to it. Essentially, it's a bit learning curve when we come new to JavaScript. But once we have it, then it's kind of easy. And then we have something called hooks. Hooks is something that we can prepare the test data, or we can do some specific steps for each and every test. Before we run the test, we can use the hooks for running the steps, for preparing the application to be in a specific state. We have before block, we have after, so which runs before every test specification is run, and after is for any steps that we need to run after all the tests in the block is run. Before each runs every before the test block, and after each runs every test. Assume a case wherein we have more than 20 or 30 tests in a single specification, and Cypress has an option to run the test automatically as and when you develop the code and save it. So there's a watcher that runs the test automatically. So if we have a number of tests, then each and every time we save the specification file, all the tests will be run, which is, we do not want that scenario, right? If we want to run only a specific test case, then we can specify it.only, then only those tests will, only that test will be run. All the other tests in the specification will be ignored. Skip is exactly the opposite. If we want to skip a specific test in the test specification, then we can mention it in the it block, and then only that particular test will be ignored. Okay, so we have something called commands, as we have with the web driver as well. So we have different querying commands. That queries the DOM. So we have visit method to go to a particular website or a particular path in the app. Or we have a get method to look for a specific element within the DOM, and then we can do an actions on it. And there are actionability commands as well. So we can click on an element, double click on an element, type some text in an input field. We can clear the input field. We can check boxes and check. So there are different inbuilt actionability commands as well, querying commands as well within Cypress. As you can see in the code block, we have a visit command. So visit command specifies the relative path. The absolute path is picked from the base URL. So we can specify the domain name in the base URL, and we can specify only the relative path in the visit. Yep. So we also have something called assertions. So we query the DOM for a specific element, and we can do some assertions on it. Right. So there are different assertions, and commands retry the assertions automatically. For example, let's say we look for an element in a DOM, and due to some XHR request, the element is not in a specific state. So within the timeout, Cypress automatically retries the command and the relevant assertion. So we don't need to really write the looping ourselves. So Cypress automatically take care of it. And there are different assertions from Chai framework. We have implicit, which is should. Should contains different selectors in it. So as you can see in the code block here, we can run a contain selector. We can check whether a particular tag contains this particular text. Yeah. So there are multiple selector cases which will be really tedious to go through now. Yeah. And as I said earlier, we can also stub responses. If the network request takes a lot of time, then we can stub the responses, put it in a fixture, and then stub it to the request so that we can validate the URL. And also we can do assets on requests and responses. There was a time when I was using Python WebDriver, and I had to really look at the network response, request and response. But WebDriver by default wasn't able to give it. So I had to look for workaround. By the time I used the request module to make a request and then validate it, basically. So, but when I switched to Cypress, it was pretty easy. Yeah. So we have the hold on the request and the response, which we can validate. Fixtures, as I said, to manage any data in the test, we can pass the fixtures to the test and then invoke it at runtime. WebDriver, we have a famous framework, page objects, right? So Cypress, out of the box, it doesn't have it, but there's a workaround. We can create page objects in Cypress as well. But the Cypress team supports using custom commands. So instead of page object, as I said, in the support library directory, we can have custom commands. For example, when we frequently use a certain command, we can make it as a custom command and then invoke in all the test specifications. And the other important concept is alias. If you look at these two code blocks, before each is a hook and it is a test case. Now we need to pass the text value that we found in before each to the it block, right? So normally we can create a variable on top of the specification and then pass it around from JavaScript. But if we use an alias is nothing but dot as text. So this is an alias. So using which we can refer the value from other test blocks as well. So we can pass the values around. Okay, so another important concept is timeout, as with every web testing. So we have the option to set the timeout at the global level, which we do it in the configuration, as well as we can specify the timeout in the respective command itself. The reason being, by default, the timeout is 4 seconds. But we can chain commands and assertion in a Psi driver. So it's a Psi driver. We can chain commands and assertions in it. So all these assertions and the commands, they have the same timeout specified in the global. Right? So what if this takes more time? So then we have an option to specify the timeout exclusive for this particular command. So normal it's 4 seconds, but this timeout is 10 seconds because we think that, okay, this assertion will take more time. We have the option to do it, yeah. Okay, so any questions until now? Okay. So I'll go back to the code. Sorry. I'll go back to the code which we wrote earlier. So we have the Cypress directory, and we have fixtures in it, and integration is where the test specifications will go into. So I'm going to write a simple test. So I've created a test specification under integration. This is a JavaScript stack sugar. just gives me the references by default. So as I said, in a test specification, we start with the describe block. Okay, so we give a description for the describe. And then we have the function. Yeah, so we write everything within this describe block. So we have, we can write a eight block. So instead of function, we can also use an arrow function. So it's a lambda function. So size or driver, so we can visit any particular site. So we have the test runner now, and you can, as you can see, the test runner is able to find the specification which I just wrote. So when I run it, it visits the web page and it's done, right? But as you see, we just gave the URL google.com, but Cypress is able to identify whatever AJAX request the site is able to make. So if you want to really test the entirety of the application, sometimes we want to test the XHR request as well, which we can identify from the command log. So this is a test runner, and this is the command log. So command log watches over the request and response, and it saves the DOM state before and after a request is made. As you can see, in the web, in the browser here at the bottom, so it has captured the DOM snapshot each and every time when a request is made, as you can see here. And also we have the option to inspect the DevTools, inspect the application using the DevTools. So that's one another advantage with Cypress. Yep. So as you can see, the test runner, it's pretty handy. So it tells how many tests were passed and it tells how many tests were failed. And this is the total time it took. And each and every test, it watches what all the different requests that made and what all the different command that get executed and what all the different assertions that were made, whether it is a pass or not. And this we call it as a command log. We have the option to rerun the same test again. And this is a URL preview. It gives which particular URL the DOM, the site request was made. And there's something else called viewport. We have the option to run the website at different devices. So we can specify what is the length and breadth. We can run it against different length and breadth of it. And this is the app preview, which is shown for each and every DOM snapshot.
Question.
Yep.
Yeah.
So as I said, Cypress gives the opportunity to debug when the test is run. So we can give a command like debugger. Between in the test specification, we can specify the word debugger. So the test stops at that point, and we have the opportunity to look at the DOM state at that point. Yeah. And also, we after the test is run, we there's another option called dot debug, so which is also helpful in verifying a particular state of the request. Okay, so I'll just so all the time we have seen the Cypress in the dev mode, right? So as you can see, if I make any change in the code, the Cypress watcher reruns the test automatically. Let's say Okay, it's okay. I'm going to open another repo. Give me a second. So I'm invoking Cypress at a different repo. So Cypress opens up the runner. Okay, I have another test here, so which I run, which is basically going to Google and then look for a specific, search for a word and then open its first website, right? So as you see here, visit is not, this particular test is not executed because I might have skipped it. Yeah, so I have just skipped it. So I'm removing the skip and then saving it. Cypress will be able to automatically detect that some change is made and it will rerun the test automatically. Now it has run visit. Yeah. And Cypress uses by default same origin, meaning we can test only a single domain. For example, sg.carousel.com, right? But what if we want to navigate to different domains, especially on the XHR request, we want to go to different sites. We have the option to disable it so that we can specify in cypress.json. So as you see here, I have disabled the Chrome Web Security. So when this option is specified, Cypress can navigate to different domains. Especially in end-to-end tests, we'll be needing to move to different domains, right? Yep, so, okay. All this while we have seen Cypress in dev mode, right? So what if we want to run in continuous integration, right? So we have another command called Cypress run. Okay, I guess it's not visible. Let me bring it up. Okay, so we have the option to run specific cases. So assume we have multiple specifications which we want to run, but we are interested to run only a specific case. Then we have the option to specify in the command line. So when does this run? By default, Cypress uses Electron browser, not Chrome. We have the option to give run in Chrome by specifying the browser. So this runs in headless. It doesn't open any browser. So it's invoking the test. It's running in Electron browser. Okay, so it ran two test cases and it says all passed. So if all the cases passed, there'll be no screenshot, obviously. But as I said, by default, it gives a video, right? So this is the video it get created. So I'm just playing the video. So we didn't do anything, right? But this is by default. Yep, there's a slight issue here as you notice. The last step is not complete, but the video is complete. This is a known issue on Cypress. Okay, so you've seen. Okay, I would like to fail a test and then show you the screenshot as well. So I've purposely made the test to fail. As you see, it took some time, right? So it retries the looking for the element. So by the time the timeout was reached, it just came out. As you can see, for failure test, we have the screenshot. So we can look at it and then see why it's failing. So the screenshots will be available under the Cypress folder, under screenshots. And this is the screenshot that's just created. I purposely look for element that was not available here, and then Cypress failed in here. Yep. It doesn't? Okay, so for logging the error, we have the, if we open it in the development mode, so we can have exactly the DOM state, why it failed. Yeah. In fact, we can, from the failure at that point, we can print out the error in the console. And the error, okay, I can show you the video. It will fail at this point, but will the video capture is what I'm thinking. Yeah, so here you can see the log. Cypress error, timed out retrying, expected the element locator and then to contain a particular value, but it wasn't there. Yep. So we have seen this. There's plenty available on Cypress, which I haven't covered. Dashboard is something which is a paid service for a private repo in GitHub. And for public repo, it's free, so we can use it. In Dashboard, we can see the test insights, how it's run, what all the cases fail. It's something like a paid version. And parallelization is not that great in Cypress. I would have to agree with that. The reason is the way it's run in JavaScript, it doesn't it doesn't support cross browser, and the other, it runs within the browser and it doesn't support parallelization. For parallelization, right now the state is we have to run it on multiple machines. Yes, as I said, debugging I haven't covered much, but there's an option to debug during the test. Yeah, it helps a lot. And there are references. Cypress has done a wonderful documentation. They have, in fact, explain what Cypress can do, and also they have explained why it's done that way. So it's really great in terms of documentation. And Brian Mann is the one who's founded Cypress. So you can find his intro on Cypress at this link. Yeah, Cypress repo, it's in GitHub. It's open source. You can very well look at it. Roadmap, as I said, Firefox support is in progress. Not sure when exactly it'll be done. But there are other priority features as well in pipeline. The sample apps I have shown you is one of the app. There are plenty other apps which Cypress use for testing. So you can see it in the sample apps link. Yep. Any questions? Yep. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Right now we don't have, I mean Cypress doesn't have Selenium grid kind of architecture, but dashboard is something which we can look at. It helps parallelization, but it's a paid service for private repos.
Write the feedback and submit to us.